Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Professor Elijah Cooks, chairman of the Department of Business Studies here at Prince George's Community College in Largo, Maryland. I would first of all, I would like to honor, I should say recognize, Dr. Lorraine Bissett. She is the interim dean of the Social Science and Business Division. Dr. Bissett, would you please stand? Thank you. Also, I would like to recognize Dr. Faith Breen. She is the visionary who first conceived, nurtured, and brought to fruition the Millennium series. Dr. Breen, thank you. Distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, students, etc., it gives me great pleasure to welcome you and to chair the opening ceremonies this afternoon to the 22nd annual Millennium Series. This event is jointly organized by the Prince George's Community College Hillman Entrepreneurs Program and the college's Business Collegian Center. I am honored and would like to thank Ruth Lewis, director of the Hillman Entrepreneurial Program, and Professor Pamela Wilson, coordinator of the Business Collegian Center, for asking me to chair this event. The significance of the Millennium Series has been recognized by many governmental entities and a host of business roundtables. The Millennium Series has received numerous acclaims, accolades, lauds, and awards from a variety of entities throughout the Mid-Atlantic region. The Millennium Series has been fundamental in bringing high-level governmental, business, and entrepreneurial leaders to the School of Business here at Prince George's Community College. The series' critical mission statement is to immerse Prince George's Community College students with the best and the brightest business, governmental, and entrepreneurial talent, and our business students will excel in business proficiency, governmental incomparability, and in immutable entrepreneurial heights. So with that said, I would like to turn this event over to a Hillman Entrepreneur student, Mr. Chris Wright.
Guten Tag. For those that do not understand me, that means good afternoon. It is great to see you. Today, I have the honor of introducing our Millennium speaker. Our guest speaker today faced a lot of obstacles in his lifetime. He was originally placed in the foster care system. In his early childhood, he was placed in special education and had to repeat the fourth grade due to poor academic performance. Inspirational to see that he has gone from having below a 1.5 GPA in his freshman year of high school to having a bachelor's degree from Morehouse College and a master's degree from Yale University. The guest we have today is the founder of Forever Life Productions, a company that is responsible for creating custom videos for special occasions and events. He is also the best-selling author of the educational memoir entitled A New Day One, Trauma, Grace, and a Young Man's Journey from Foster Care to Yale. He has spoken at various locations around the world, as well as in the U.S. at Yale and the White House, about the importance of financial literacy for urban youth. And just for today, he has made Prince George's Community College his home. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce Mr. Rodney Walker.
Good afternoon. I want to thank Prince George's Community College for allowing me the opportunity to speak today to the faculty and staff, to Dr. Breen, Dr. Bissett, Ms. Wilson for following up with me to make sure that this event was possible and that I made my flight and that I made my arrangements and that I was here on time. Ms. Wilson and the students, obviously my peers, I want to thank you for allowing me the honor and the privilege of sharing this with you to talk about not only the importance of entrepreneurship education, but also to talk about what the concept of being business-minded and having an entrepreneurial spirit can do to transform your life and your reality. Safe to say that I'm the byproduct of many things, both good and bad, in my lifetime. But in my short 27 years of living, I would like to say that beyond what entrepreneurship did for me to help change my circumstances, I would say it did much more for me mentally and psychologically to help me understand my circumstances for what they were, to accept them for what they were, to be humble for those circumstances, and to then chart a new path for myself and my life. The business that I started in my senior year of high school was called Forever Life Music and Video Production. And essentially what this business was an organization that created movies out of weddings and graduations. So simply put, if you were engaged and you were planning a wedding, we would do pre-videos, interviews. We would have collected video footage of you in advance, and we would culminate that into an experience that was somewhat like a reality series. But this is a special moment for many couples in relationships because it really quantified in a very beautiful way the power of relationships, the power of love, and also the power of creating lasting memories. The quote for Forever Life Productions was, we make memories last forever. And beyond the experience of creating the business, I have the great pleasure of having created memories for a lifetime that many people will be able to share. That business serves as a subsidiary of Morehouse College, where I then took the business and worked on film production there. And since leaving it there, I moved forward with studying more about business and entrepreneurship. Today, I serve as a program manager for Chicago Public Schools, where I run a jobs program for at-risk youth across the city. And youth will have the opportunity to work different jobs as a way of staying out of the streets, as a way of being engaged in school, as a way of being motivated, and a way of being financially supported. Most of our kids are living below the poverty line. They're living, they have an educational disparity. So we believe that having this economic income while also having a mentorship component will allow them the privilege of being able to look at their lives differently, to see opportunity in a different way, and to use that to their advantage going forward. But among talking about business, entrepreneurship, and what creating this enterprise has done for me, despite the fact that how much money I've made and how much opportunity has come my way, what's more important for me that happened in my life experience is being able to push my pain to greatness. I had a mentor that used to say that the DNA for greatness was already in me. I just needed the space, the place, the time, and the people who were in positions to deliver that to me. It was never a question of whether or not I could be successful. It was a question of who's going to take up the mantle and be that caring adult that I needed, that was going to give me the resources, the support, the guidance, the love, and the nurturing that I needed to see my pain and my adversity as just a vehicle to motivate and inspire others to do the same. Beyond having that mentor and having the business experience that I have, that's what entrepreneurship means to me. And that literally is the fabric of my foundation. My story really begins with my mother. She's a byproduct of Chicago's public housing projects. She's the byproduct of a rape by her father at 12 years old. She's the byproduct of abandonment by her mother. She's the byproduct of deep poverty that she was not able to escape in her early life. She dropped out of the seventh grade, had her first child at 13 years old, lost her second child in a house fire, and was never able to recover from that. My mother fell into deep depression, my father as well, and that really culminated, it was the onset for the war on drugs in the 1980s that really made her susceptible to that drug use. So my blueprint began in foster care. My parents were incarcerated when I was 5 years old, and I went into foster care at five, and I experienced a whirlwind of life-shattering circumstances in this process. I was abused physically, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, spiritually. And after having went through all of that, in my last foster home, I took the liberty of running away, and I relied on my friends and even strangers in homeless shelters to look after me while I figured my life out. The abuse had culminated to a point where I didn't even feel the need to think about my life's plans, what I can do to excel in life. Because I was homeless, I was starving, I lost massive weight in my last year of high school. And all the while I was going through these experiences of homelessness and hopelessness, I always asked myself, what does this mean in the long term? Like, what is all this for? I know that I wasn't perfect as a child, and I know that I have been through a lot of different things and I made many mistakes, but why this adversity? Why this trauma? I categorize it as social-emotional trauma, and what it does is it literally impacts and stifles growth and development for young people, and I was an extreme byproduct of that. I never lost the why, though, because even though I was going through the abuse and the neglect and the trauma, I always asked, how and why did this happen? So I had to go back to figure out what it was about my life and my parents and my siblings that made this a reality for us. In 2008, I found all my siblings. And as soon as I found my siblings, no sooner than I found them, I started losing people. I lost my brothers to drug habits, drug abuse, violence. My family, in a big way, was torn apart because of these reasons. My community was dilapidated. It was disenfranchised. Underprivileged is an understatement to all of what we've went through. My brothers were susceptible to gang violence and the like. But I can't say enough about the way that drugs literally rippled my family to pieces. So much so that when I found my mother in 2008, for the first time in a long time, she was barely recognizable. My mother, in her early life, wanted to be a nurse. She wanted to help people. She wanted to heal people. But her own brokenness from a system that couldn't support the psychological damage that life had done to her sent her spiraling in a very big way. My father's no different, having been a byproduct of the Vietnam War in 1968 with an aggressive heroin addiction that shattered his life. And so it is no wonder that of the 10 children that they had, most of them struggled in their early life. Being around the drug element that my parents were involved in, being around a community that was so infested with drugs and gangs and violence. The south side of Chicago and the west side of Chicago really began to spiral in that way for a very long period of time. And my siblings were unfortunate byproducts of that. And more than what it did to their spirit and their bodies, it had a much devastating effect on their mind and what they wanted and what they could do with themselves.
At least 20 kids have been shot so far this school year, and just this weekend, 7 more students were shot.
I want to make a quick emphasis on Chicago's violence. In the early 80s, there were 25,000 shootings in a three-month span. That really took a toll on the south and west side of Chicago. One thing that I think is important to mention is that with violence in that regard came a deeper onset of violence. Having the children who are playing outside and who didn't understand the ramifications of that, of the drug trade and how violence came with that, left a lot of casualties. And in fact, over 50% of the shootings and the homicides were just innocent bystanders on the street. I grew up in a neighborhood called Englewood, which is on the south side of Chicago, which in the mid-80s culminated with about 30% of the shootings and the violence. More than just understanding the ramifications of the gun laws and the political activism that took place during that time to help rectify the violence, rectify what was going on with young people and why they were so disconnected from education and so disconnected from being able to recover. In a very deep way, what was not being addressed was the trauma that led to the after effect of the violence. that what we were beginning to understand is that it just wasn't the victims that were losing their lives, it was the perpetrators that were losing their lives as well. And that's the most unfortunate part of what's happening in our cities, is that there are many young people who are too young to understand their mistakes and the ramifications, who will never be able to see what we see now. They'll never be able to see a college campus. They'll never be able to have faculty and mentors who are able to guide them in the right direction, and they won't even have that opportunity. And so much was so for my siblings and my family all across the city. My trauma was so deep that at one point it got to the surface, and I had to ask myself, what are we going to do? I had been making mistake after mistake. I had been in and out of foster homes. I went to school for the most part, but there are many days I didn't even go to school because I didn't understand the point. My parents were nowhere to be found throughout this whole process, and sometimes I would go to sleep asking, you know, my father who wasn't there, like, where were you at? You know, I asked my mother, like, you know, I mean, I'm all over the place. I have no guidance or direction. What did you do and where were you at? And living with that reality put me at such a serious deficit, because the absence of my parents, beyond what it did to me physiologically, it tore my body apart. It did a lot more for me spiritually to damage me, because not growing up with a family, and my estimated opinion is the number one cause of youth and violence in our country today. It's not that you have access to a gun. It's not that you have access to drugs. It's not that you have access to illegal activity and illegal things, elements. But the number one cause of violence among young people is the fact that they have an unstable household, unstable home, that their father is not there for whatever reason, that their mother is unable to be a mother for whatever reason. And I carried these things with me all while I was in high school. I couldn't focus, I was distracted, my life was torn apart, and I couldn't understand how someone can do this to their children. But even in feeling that way, I never let my parents go, and I never let my family go. My number one motive and objective was to get back with my family as long as I was in foster care, because I knew I had two younger sisters who were struggling with foster care. They would be aging out soon, and they would be homeless as soon as they aged out of foster care. I knew I had a vision that life can't be like this, that I wanted to be a college graduate. I wanted to be successful. I wanted to take vacations. I wanted to just enjoy the wonders of life. I wanted to be the father that I never had in my life. I wanted to be the parent that I never had in my life. I wanted to be the mentor and the guidance counselor that I never had. All these things I wanted, all these things I knew I can have and achieve. But as soon as I stepped out of that reality, I had to face the fact that I had a 1.3 in my sophomore year of high school and a 1.6 in my junior year. I had to go to summer school twice, that I was living in dilapidated circumstances, that as beautiful as Chicago was and as prosperous as it was, that I lived in a neighborhood that was infested with rats and roaches, that the grass wasn't green, that the concrete was cracked, that I had termites in my house, that my parents lived in abandoned circumstances, even though they had checks that went to their drug habits, they couldn't provide heat or hot water or food in the refrigerator, and I had to live under these circumstances while they had to try to figure their life out. From 2004 to 2008, about 25 people that I knew were victims of shootings who had lost their lives to gun violence. And this violence had the adverse effect on me psychologically, because most people will be torn apart by that. But, you know, I never lost sight of what life could be like if we allowed ourselves to feel and to think, really think about what life could be like if we had everything that we wanted. We do so much focusing on what we don't want, what we're trying to avoid, getting kids out, that we don't focus on where they're running to. And when they get out and they go over there, like, well, they don't want them over there. we're running away from our families and our communities to find something that doesn't exist instead of reinvesting and focusing on what's already there. And that's where my mind was. That why can't we have concrete that's actually smooth and grass that's green and fathers who are walking their children to school, mothers who are there to pick their children up from school, two-parent households where there's actually stability, discipline for our youth, children who are playing outside and trips to the park with your parents. These are all the things that I thought about that I didn't have the privilege of growing up with. And I thought about, in a real way, from my visualization, what would a day in the life be like for a child who had the privilege of having these experiences. And that's the type of person that I want to be. Despite the fact that my community was literally tearing me apart every day, that all I needed was one opportunity to get out to be that father that I never had, or that mother that I never had, or create the infrastructure and the support system necessary for my children to thrive. I thought like this at a young age because my circumstances was just that deep. And every day I went to sleep with that image in my mind. Like, I would say it, like, I want that. I want that. You know, I would look at things and say, I want that experience. And every day I woke up and it wasn't there, and it motivated me beyond that point to go get it, to search for it, and to do whatever I had to do to get there. In the interim of these two worlds that I was juggling, the world to stay hopeful and the world where I was hopeless, I had to wrestle with what direction did I could I go, because I had no guidance. I didn't have the education about what to do, what next steps to take. And this is why I say it's such a difference between knowing better and doing better. I knew that I wanted something better. I didn't necessarily understand how to get it. And that's why I had the fortune of meeting a mentor in my senior year of high school, who was the dean of my high school at the time, who really took an interest in helping me through my life's complex issues. He didn't focus on my homework. He didn't focus on my academics per se. He didn't focus on my mental instability. He focused on my motive. He focused on my goals. He focused on my aspirations. He said, "If what would you do if you can do anything for free and get paid for it, what would you do?" And that was the start of my entrepreneurial journey. Starting the video production business in my senior year culminated out of a desire to do what I would do for free, a passion that I already had, which at the time was video production. And from nurturing that passion, I was able to build an infrastructure for my business and create a demand for that. I won business plan competitions in my senior year of high school. I became more involved in school as a byproduct of that passion. I became more engaged in school as a byproduct of having that interest. And that's when things began to unfold because of the desire that I had for my life and figuring out something that I can do for myself. My parents attended their first graduation in 2008. My grades and my academics turned around as a byproduct of having that one parent, that one adult, I always say it, that one adult who thought enough of me to not give up. And I didn't have that until 2008. My parents, despite all that they've went through, knew that day that everything that they had went through wasn't for nothing. And when I began to let them go and let my family go and let my adversity take its course through me, the people who were meant to be in my life began to surface. Mentors, role models, people who were already there began to come into my peripheral. And that's really when my life began to unfold. Upon entering college, I had a deeper ambition that I didn't just want to survive in spite of Chicago. I wanted to thrive in spite of Chicago. That south side of Chicago didn't actually make me, didn't break me, it actually made me into something different. Thriving allowed me to create a vision board, which I encourage everybody to do. vision board really propelled me in everything that I did going forward into college, and my mentors never left my side. I wanted to live life in its fullest. It was never just about graduating college, even though I graduated college. It was literally just about doing things that should be the status quo, the norm for kids. But for me, it was so, you know, foreign and I'm so different that most people didn't experience life till its fullest. I wanted to travel. I wanted to see how other people lived. I wanted to see how other people experienced the world. I wanted to see what pain and trauma looked like across the globe. I wanted to help. I wanted to give back. I wanted to do community service abroad. I wanted to get my family back. I wanted to work towards what it does it look like to have a family, because I didn't know what it looked like. I wanted to literally put myself in the position that if I did have the privilege of that world that I wanted, well, what would I do? I wanted to get my mind away from everything that was broken about my life and everything that my life could be. And everything about what I invested in my time and my energy and my money went towards that. My boldness led me to Yale University, because while I was so stuck on education, I knew that I deserved more and I deserved better. I knew that I deserved to have a life that many people have today, despite my circumstances. Education and entrepreneurship and what it did for me in my entirety pushed me to my greatness, and I'm thankful for that. But what I'm thankful for more than anything else in the world is that the right people came into my life to do for me what I wasn't able to do for myself. And that my mother didn't go through what she went through for nothing. Much of my success when it did come, graduating from Morehouse, graduating from Yale, after all these accomplishments and all these experiences, the first person I thought about was that father figure that I never had. And the second person I thought about was my mother, that I wasn't a mistake and she didn't do what she did for nothing. And I'll say this about how that culminated into my book, that the basis for my book is that no one can go back and make a new beginning, but anyone can start today and make a new ending. Circumstances may determine your reality and it may even alter your path, but it doesn't have to be a means to your end. My mentor has a favorite saying that, you know, life is a fight for territory, and once you stop fighting for what you don't want will automatically take its course. And life has been just that much of a fight. But having the tenacity and the humility and the resilience that's necessary to compete with life's challenges will ultimately get you to your goal. And understanding what that goal is and what you can do moving forward will get you there no matter what life throws at you. So thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you today. So yeah, I know we do questions and just a little bit more about where I'm going today. I finish up with Chicago Public Schools, which is where I've been working for the last several months, leading the jobs program. I'll be continuing my education in the human development and psychology program at Harvard University in the fall to pursue a doctorate. And the book that I wrote last year has done very well. Again, it's called A New Day One, Trauma, Grace, and the Young Man's Journey from Foster Care to Yale. It should have probably put Yale and beyond, because again, the story didn't stop at Yale, but Yale is just a manifestation of the renewed energy and the mindset that I have to do things differently and go forward. And so I'm glad that that book has been so receptive. I'm glad to be speaking across the country to students, young people, about the power of positivity, the power of visualization, and the power of positive thinking. And the last thing I'll say is that it all comes down to choices, that it's so hard to talk about choices without talking about trauma because of where I am, but the difference between where I am and where my siblings are and where my community continues to be, where young people continue to be in at-risk, disadvantaged, impoverished, disenfranchised neighborhoods across our country, is the choices that they are making. And I understand choices are dictated on mental, psychological, and social trauma. But if we can find a way to rewire the brain and dictate and to re-image their circumstances in such a way that they make different choices in light of their adversity, I believe that that's what will be necessary to help kids who are really going through it today. I know I actually spoke like an academic when I did that, but like I just believe that you change your mind, you change your life. That's my biggest motto, and I think that if we can find a way to do that in a very strategic way, that we'll be better off in the long run. So, thanks. So, I take any questions.
I noticed in one of your photographs that you were in the United Arab Emirates. What took you there? Was that business or pleasure?
So I've been to 12 different countries already, and Dubai was a great experience. I think I was there for just because I wanted to go. When I was in college, I had a friend who said that I told him that I wanted to study abroad. And he asked me what I wanted to study abroad for, and I said, I don't know what I want to study abroad. He said, well, why are you doing that then? Why are you applying for programs to go abroad when you don't even know what you want to go for? Why don't you just go, save up some money, and just go? And I said, well, I only speak English. I don't speak Spanish or any other language, so I don't know how to do that, and I don't even know the process. He says, okay, listen, get a passport, just head out, and when you get there, you'll figure it out. And so that's what I did, and I've been traveling ever since. So, yeah.
I was wondering how you were able to get into all of the schools and how long it took you to get your master's and bachelor's and everything like that, and how you were able to afford it.
So I applied to 13 different schools in high school, and I was denied at all 12 schools except one school, which accepted me on academic probation, which is Morehouse College. They have a special program for students who all they have to have is a strong personal statement, some good recommendations, and despite the fact that they don't have the grades, they have the opportunity to basically show that they have a determination to succeed. So Morehouse College accepted me on probation. I took all remedial classes in my first semester, so elementary math, Spanish, basic English, composition, but I was genuinely motivated at that point. I had never been out of Chicago. I went to Atlanta, and Atlanta was great. Atlanta inspired me probably more than Morehouse College itself, because I was away from Chicago and I was around so many educated, young African American men that really propelled me. So I just needed one opportunity, and that's really what did it for me. Yale, after Morehouse, I was really determined to never apply to 13 different schools ever again. In fact, going forward, I just figured that if I wanted something, I would be okay with not getting it. And I think that's really a part of the entrepreneurial spirit and mindset, is that is this idea of risk taking. I wouldn't have felt good if I had applied to many schools and didn't get into the one I wanted. It's really very important to focus on what you want. So after Morehouse, I said that if I went to graduate school, I would only apply to one school. So when I applied to school, I only applied to Yale. And I did get into Yale for my master's. And when I applied to doctoral programs, I only applied to one doctoral program. And I didn't have to get into these schools. And if I didn't get into these schools, I probably would have applied again, which I think is also important. But I got in the first time. So so I'm really glad to be on my next educational journey. And appreciative that Morehouse gave me the opportunity that they gave me to continue my education beyond high school. So, yeah.
Where did your love for video production come from?
So Chicago has this very interesting music scene, and it actually started in 2007. And I was one of the people who used this program called, it was called FL Studio. It's called Fruity Loops. It's like a music, it's this program where you can put music beats together. And I had the computer with the box computer, like the Apple, the original like computer that was like a box computer, and I had Netscape and I had used my phone cord, and we would just be in our bedroom just playing with the program, and that those music beats led to music scores for videos that we created, which started off as like rap videos, basically, because I had like a small camera. And then that started off making like music videos. And then when the opportunity presented itself to join an entrepreneurship program, that's the first thing that came to my mind. This is something I do every day. I would love to make a business out of it. Now, people weren't buying music videos, but I thought about what they could buy. And the thing that I knew was a huge market in Chicago in general, but everywhere generally, is that there's always gonna be weddings and graduations. And so I took advantage of that and built the business around video production and, you know, marketed it. And that's how it became successful. It's just genuinely doing it for the fun of it. And it, you know, through the process of entrepreneurship education, it became a business through mentorship and coaching. So, appreciate it.
Hi, I just wanted to ask you about your academics and how your academics and your passion of entrepreneurship, how did you put that all together? And I know you worked a lot on your own. Did you have any influence with other peers in your classrooms or activities at the school to help you build your journey?
Right, so I was very fortunate to be a part of a very comprehensive entrepreneurship education program. The organization was called the Network for Teaching Entrepreneurship. Then it was called the National Foundation for Teaching Entrepreneurship. And this program was implemented in a business class that I had in high school. And we had an entire curriculum, basically a PowerPoint that we had to, you know, fill in the blank. So it was already a part of a curriculum. We had a teacher who taught the whole course in our class. And everything actually that we learned in our math classes and English classes in high school was implemented into the business plan itself in that business class. So it was no real way that we could learn the business material in that class without learning the math and the English material in our other classes. So it really married together in that way. So even if you didn't want to do any other class with business, you had to by default, especially because they were so interconnected. One of the marketing points that the business class used is we have a $10,000 business plan competition at the end of the year, and we're looking for students to participate in this course to prepare them for that business plan. So we had the in-class competition, then we had the regional competition and national. Well, kids were so excited about the $10,000 and less about the business that they just signed up because they heard the money. So when they did that, we had just like a room filled with students who were eager to learn about it. So that's how they attracted the students. Then they provided all the students with mentors or coaches from the business community that then helped them with their individual business plans. And it was so easy and fluid for them because it wasn't like they were teaching the kids anything. They were just directing the kids in the way that they already wanted to go, because these kids were doing something that they already wanted to do, that they were doing outside of school anyway. And so it was easy for them, it was easy for the students. And that's really how I was able to marry my education with entrepreneurship. Beyond high school, because my business had done so well, I was able to, when I went to Morehouse College, I did take up business as a concentration, philosophy as a default concentration. And because of what I had learned in high school and from those coaches, I was able to continue that track on into college. And the last pitch that they made for the students is that, and they did this in the business plan competition where the $10,000 was like this big thing, is that $10,000 is just a drop in a very big bucket. And that if you want to have real impact and make real money, you go to college. And they have, you know, large scale business plan competitions with more opportunity to make money and make an impact. And so that's really what drove kids to even apply to college from my business class, is this idea that, well, I didn't win this competition, but I could win the competition in college if I apply to college. And so that's really what drove that kind of cycle of from business and education in high school to entrepreneurship at the collegiate level. And luckily we had community colleges partner with our high school because they knew this program was happening. They partnered with the high school to basically feed students into their program. So it all worked out that way.
Hello, my name is Olu. So my question is, since you like doing videos, so I was asking, like, maybe your high school, or like, have you connected with creators in that school in order to like nurture their gifts, whatever gifts that it may be, in order for them to use it for like a source of income? And how may you go through that plan?
You asked if I did a business plan for those kids?
Yeah, like, have you, like, those gifts that they've like created, maybe, for example, for me, I like doing events. And maybe for somebody else, it may be producing. Mm-hmm. Somebody else, it may be poetry. So how have you how have you nurtured those gifts? And like, what was the plan or the process?
Right, right. So today, being back in Chicago, out of school, I actually do serve as a business coach for that same class that I was in high school. And I currently work with a student now who's actually doing basically shoe design. So he designs shoes. And I don't tell him anything about how to construct the business. I just tell him the specifics about the business plan, the economics of one unit, the marketing plan, the social responsibility plan, the cost of materials, direct labor, all those things. But he comes up with the vision. He comes up with like the direction of what he wants his business to be, which is so fluid for him because he does that anyway, and he did it as a part of the business plan. So as a coach, I'm able to do that for him. Of the students, my high school always encourages the students who went through the business plan competition in the class, which usually happens in their junior year of high school, because senior year they encourage them to come back and to then coach the next class of the business class. So it's not just me I also did it my senior year. So it's not just me, but it's also a revolving door of some sorts of the students who go back and help them to complete that business plans also.
Rodney, can you tell us what you're going to study when you go to Yale, and then some of your plans once you finish your doctorate degree?
Okay, so I'll be honest that I don't know what my plans will be after I finish. I will say that I'm going to, when I go to Harvard, I'm going to be studying in the Department of Human Development and Psychology. It is a concentration under the School of Education. And generally what my studies will be about will be focusing on how we can address social-emotional trauma with youth, and how we can eliminate that trauma or minimize that trauma to help them to eliminate those distractions to achieve better life outcomes. So a large part of my work will be working with the professors there on a couple of initiatives that they've created, such as the Making Caring Common Project. They also have an initiative called the Chicago School Readiness Project, which focuses on early childhood education in Chicago's public schools up until the time that they graduate, and what are the social, psychological, and the cultural implications of living in those environments, dealing with some of the issues that they deal with, and how we as mentors, role models, and business leaders and educators can help influence a different life trajectory. So generally speaking, what I really want to do is to focus on just how devastating an impact social-emotional trauma has on young people. Really simply put, if you are someone like me who grew up in a home where, you know, your father and your mother wasn't there, or your father was there but he was abusive, and your mother was raped so that she doesn't know how to raise children, she had a first child at 13 years old, or if you're in a neighborhood where there's gun violence and you hear like whistles of bullets flying past your house every day, and you like walk an 8-block radius from your house to school, and you see all these systemic elements, how do we somehow denormalize that and somehow find a way to rewire the brain and to alter that reality so that they can make better choices, feel better about themselves despite that happening, and come up with a program, because this is ultimately what I want to do, come up with a program that helps them understand that trauma and that adversity in a very positive way, even though it doesn't seem to be anything positive about it. That's a program model. Generally speaking, what I do believe, though, is that you cannot address widespread social-emotional trauma in urban communities without addressing the political landscape and how it literally impacts and affects social and cultural and educational systems in our country. Basically, what that means is that if I am a mentor and I go into a high school and I mentor kids, and there are 100 kids, my mentorship alone can probably save, of that 100, 25 kids, if they're really going through life-shattering circumstances, like I mentioned. However, if you change policy, if you change systems, if you change institutions, then you might get 75 out of 100, with 25 just being casualties, because it's just a fact of life. You have casualties and data. No data is perfect. So I take pride in my mentorship. I take pride in understanding that and studying it. However, I know that the reality is that no matter how much mentorship we do, no matter how much social emotional trauma counseling that we do, as long as mass incarceration exists, where their father's not in the home, and there's a drug epidemic that continues to perpetuate and infiltrate the economic status of our communities, that in itself won't alter the scale or tip the scale in favor of more Black and brown students graduating from college than not. That every Black and brown student that graduates from college literally is a exception to the rule rather than the rule itself, not because of what they do or because they don't have the capacity, but because our institutions are stifling the growth so much that they're not even able to see that different reality. So that's what I really hope to do in my program, is to find out what, create a comprehensive model to help kids who are already going through it, but to also be engaged in policy work that can help five-year-olds who have not yet went through it divert from it, from changing policy and systems and institutions. So I know it's a long-winded answer. But
you have another question.
I just wanted to ask you something. As far as your book, how was it like reflecting on your life, writing the book? What made you write the book? I know you said you like to make an impact on people's lives, so I knew that could have helped into it, but I just wanted to know more about that and the process.
Yeah, the process was tough. It took about 2.5 years writing. And in fact, I didn't write it to make it a book. I just wrote it to journal about my life experiences, which I think is very important in terms of the journey. I hate to actually throw this caveat in there, but just because I'm so compelled to do it, it's like, it's really like my fitness pal. Like, you don't need to track your meals every day. You don't actually need to know how many calories you need to intake every day. You just need to be disciplined. But just knowing that information every day motivates you and informs you to do different. The book really was for me to understand what I had went through. It was never to create any type of opportunity out of it. It wasn't until I met a publisher who said, this is incredible. You need to make this into a book, that I decided to partner with that publisher to create the book. And that's when I really fast-tracked my writing process. By the time I met the publisher, I had basically completed 2/3 of the book, and I just had to complete the last end of it, and I published it, and it's been great. But I will not, doing it on your own is probably the most difficult thing to do, because it just requires so much going back to places you don't want to go, and so much concentration and discipline that I, to be honest with you, did not have. and so that really helped me to get my book out, meeting the publisher who gave me that support that I needed.
Rodney, I just wanted to ask you, I'm pleased that someone asked about the book. I'm very pleased that you wrote it, but how would we get a copy of it?
So first of all, I didn't bring any copies today. From what I was told, I was going to be speaking to predominantly students. And what I wanted to do was really focus on talking about, I really wanted to talk about the nature of trauma and, just from a very deep level, why I'm so passionate about education. And education is a catchphrase word. And I actually think mentorship is a catchphrase word. I don't believe in the word mentorship in the formal sense of the word. Mentorship means you mentor from 9 to 5 or something like that. But genuine lifelong, coaching, I guess, or mentorship requires so much more than that. So I really wanted to help drive that point forward. But going back, I probably would have brought books. And so since you mentioned it, my book is available on my website at newdayone.org. It's also in Amazon. It's also in bookstores nationwide, like Barnes & Noble's, Books A Million, and Borders. And so my publisher has been really great at facilitating my book and really helping me to market it. And since having done it, it's just been really great to have it as a resource and a reference, because I can't tell the whole story of everything that I've went through and how I've learned from all the things that I've went through. So.
All right, so you said you wanted to be a father you never had. Have you achieved this goal yet?
I'm not. I have not done that. And in fact, you know, I've deliberately not done that. I've taken the very conscious approach to being able to finish my education. And in fact, again, I can't say enough about the mentor who I met in my high school year, my senior year of high school, who took that father figure role for me and instilled within me some valuable principles that I didn't learn from my father or the men in my community. And I can't really understate this fact, is that, and I know this, trust me, this is not about dating, but before I left for Morehouse College, and Morehouse is a very aggressive place to be when it comes to dating in many ways, I had a mentor who really told me about not repeating a cycle that I come from, that if you don't know your history, you're bound to repeat it. And the fact that, you know, my mother had 10 children and that she didn't understand the ramifications of her actions, having been so out in the streets and then have a father figure or a mother who was there to teach her about, you know, dating and teach her about relationships, teach her about like what she was doing in the streets, really made my life difficult and the life of my siblings difficult, despite the fact that, you know, she didn't know. So my mentor really did that for me. He said that when you date and when you decide to do that, like to do the dating, then make sure that you understand and are aware of what your family did to get you and your children and your siblings in the predicament that you are in today. And I really took that to heart because the one time I had tried to have a serious conversation with my parents, they didn't like it. They didn't like the fact that I was approaching them about certain values that they carry. My father's is a byproduct of an abusive parents. His father beat his mother every day, you know, and my mother is a byproduct of a father who cheated on her mother like all the time. And, you know, they're from Arkansas and New Orleans and where it was like prevalent. And that's something that I really had to be conscientious about. So when I say I wanted to be the father figure that I never had in my life, I mean that everything that I do now going forward is really going to position my children, should I be so grateful to have them, in the position to be successful and have no excuses for why they can't be successful. And that's really what I look forward to doing going forward. So, okay. Appreciate it.
Okay, everybody. Can you see the book? This is the book. You can get it on Amazon. Okay. Well, thank you. You've been an extraordinarily receptive audience. I appreciate all of the questions. And my job is to keep it simple. And I'm going to give you closing remarks and the lessons learned. Thank you so much, Mr. Walker, for sharing your thoughts. But this is what my takeaway was. First, embrace your past. Embrace your past and don't try to deny it. It is what it is. All right? That's the first thing. Secondly, if you haven't already done it, forgive your parents. Tell them that you love them no matter what and move on, because you're now adults. Secondly, I want each one of you to create your own vision board, and when you do it, I want you to dream really big. Don't let anybody know what your vision board is. It's your personal dream. Keep it to yourself so that nobody is going to be able to laugh at you, because that is the biggest fear that everybody in this room has. That if somebody knows what you really, really want deep in your heart, you don't want them to know. You don't want to give them that power. So keep your vision board to yourself. Third, I want you to find a mentor. You do not need to do this all by yourself. And people, don't be afraid when you've outgrown the mentor. That's what the mentor is for. The mentor is just like your parent. A parent is so happy when you move on, when we've got you launched. Just don't boomerang back home. And fourth, make sure that you become a mentor to somebody else. Because really, truly, this is just a stop along the way to your vision, to claiming your vision of what and who you want to be. So thank you very much. Thank you all.